My name's Marcia May White Egan. I've lived here all my life. My folks came over from England and on the ship Hudson. And then when they got to New York, there was the train went a little ways. They rode the train at night. And in the daytime, they would be able to sit on it. But at night, they'd have to go in the cattle cars to be safe. And then when they got to Ohio, they got in a covered wagon. And my dad, whose name was Mahanri Mor Yankimer, who it was a prophet in the Book of Mormon. And when they got to Ohio, he couldn't get in the wagon because there were three little kids besides some other passengers. There were two little girls, Keziah and Keturah, and a little boy, Ted. And my dad walked on the side of the wagon instead of riding in it. And he used my grandmother's shawl as a coverlet to sleep.
What kind of reaction you get from people when they hear his name?
Well, they are very surprised because they've never heard of it in the first place. But he was the brother of Jared in the Book of Mormon. And he was known by his family as Uncle Han.
Uncle Han?
Uh-huh. Instead of Mahanri.
Are you pretty proud of his name, Mahanri Mor Yankimer?
Yeah. And my mother taught school. They went to the temple in a horse and buggy. And she taught school. And she harnessed her own horse to a buggy at 15th East and 33rd South and went all the way to Taylorsville to teach school. And my dad, he thought my mother was so well educated, and he wasn't. He said I couldn't spell cat when we got married, in fun. But he was such a hard-working, wonderful man, it didn't matter whether he could spell or not.
Have you tried to incentivize any of your grandchildren to name their kids after him?
Well, my oldest brother was named Mahanri Kenneth. And my dad was a very wonderful Latter-day Saint.
Where did you go to high school?
Granite.
Tell us about Granite?
This morning's paper, they're starting to dismantle it. Granite High was the first seminary in the church. And we had to go across the street to go to seminary in a special little building. But they did give us credit for Old and New Testament. They gave us toward graduation. But when we took the third year of Book of Mormon, they didn't count that. And I graduated from Granite Seminary.
Did you have any accomplishments while you were at Granite High?
Yeah, I won the debate championship in 39 and 40.
Back-to-back years. Who did you go to school with any renowned people in the church?
Well, yes, Neil Maxwell went to Granite Seminary, and it was the first one in the church.
I think, didn't you mention to me one time that President James Faust went there?
Well, I didn't. They were older than I was, but.
So you never dated them, you just know they went to Granite.
Yeah. My cousin, Margaret Jacobson, was my. She introduced me to Merritt. She was at the university, and she told Merritt that she had a cousin she thinks he'd like.
So tell us a little, that was you?
Hmm?
And that was you?
Right.
Tell us a little bit about how you met Merritt and your courting.
Well, her dad was the Rhodes Scholar. He went to Oxford. And you know, it's interesting about intellectuality. I used to go to church down at Wilford Ward, And I was a bosom pal of his youngest daughter, Phyllis. And we would sit by him in church, and he always took a book. And it wasn't the Book of Mormon. I guess he didn't want to get bored, you know. But he was a good Latter-day Saint, but he was what we call, he had a little intellectualitis.
Scholarly? He was scholarly?
Yeah. He was at Oxford for a year.
So tell us a little more about you and Merritt.
Well, his other daughter, Margaret, was at the university, and I was at Granite High, and she went to a dance up at the U. A little afternoon frolic at the seminary, and she danced with him. And she said, I have a cousin I think you would like. And that was me.
And after the first time you met him, didn't you feel
something special
about Merritt?
She sent him out to my house. It was on a Sunday afternoon. And the sidewalk was all torn up because it was had to be repaired, and he walked up to the door and we got acquainted, and he asked me to go to a dance at the university. It was up at Pinecrest, and then but he was getting ready to go on a mission, and I didn't go. He invited me to his farewell, but I didn't go as his partner. I went with another fellow. And I went with the fellow that used to help me water the cows. And when we got to the farewell, he came down in the audience and invited me to come over to his house for a refreshment. And I went over with the young man that I was with. And then he sent me one note when he was en route. There were two girls on his program, but I didn't hear from him till it was time for him to come home.
Okay. And what do you remember what you were wearing when you met Merritt?
Gosh, I don't. I know that he was a little stiff when he danced, and I taught him how to do step close, rock. You can even do that to count your many blessings if you pick up the beat. And so, he was quite scholarly and timid. I took care of that.
You were a little more jazzy?
Mm-hmm.
You were a little more up.
Well, he could dance better after he had dated me. Mm-hmm. Put it that way.
So, what about, what do we want to ask him? At registration at the U. You remember registration with Merritt?
Well, yes. He brought me home from something up at the U, but we started going pretty regularly at the university.
But at registration, remember he had gotten back from his mission and you weren't too sure if he, had remembered you or if he was going to approach you. Do you remember that?
You know, I don't remember the exact incident, but we started going pretty steadily.
I remember one time you told me that you wondered whether or not he was even going to say hi to you at that registration.
Oh, well, I had plenty of attention. I had been to the university for some debate tournaments, and so I knew. And he said, "Are you gonna?" He said, "You said hello to everybody else in this room. Are you gonna say hello to me?"
There you go.
And so, I can't remember whether he brought me home or not, but we started dating.
And I wanted to ask you something else about that. Wasn't there a time when you told your friend or your cousin, once you met Merritt, even before he got back from his mission, that you knew you were going to marry him?
Well, there was some I guess we could have courted before we were born because we fell in love pretty fast.
wasn't there a time though where I'm trying to remember, you had a little run-in with your cousin. Where you remember, you've told me a story about one time where you ended up kissing your cousin. Do you remember that at all?
No.
No?
All right. She was actually my sister's age, Margaret, uh-huh. But my sister LaRue, whom the street is named after, she died of pneumonia before penicillin. My mother always used to get kind of an ache in her heart when she heard the word penicillin, because she knew it would have saved her daughter's life.
What about the picture in the tree at Christmas? Can you tell us about that?
Picture?
Of LaRue. The picture of LaRue in the tree.
Oh, yeah. Mother took it off. Dad took it off the mantle and put it in the tree. Dad was, he was a farmer, but he was sentimental.
And he said something about it's time to start singing again?
Yes. Mother hadn't been singing, and we sang a hymn, Guide Us, O Thou Great Jehovah, I guess it was. And she sang, hadn't sung for weeks. She joined in.
Oh, fantastic. So, one more question about LaRue, though. Haven't you thought maybe there's a chance that she's met Merritt up in heaven and you're okay with if Merritt decides to...
Well, who am I to interfere with the program? Whatever goes.
You wouldn't mind it if Merritt and LaRue were friends up
in
heaven?
No. She was a pretty good student. One thing that I would like you to know is that my dad was very strict about tithing. And once a year he got an envelope with $50 bills in it because they owned the grocery store on 33rd and Highland Drive. And my mother said, I want you to take some down to my Aunt Catherine because her husband has asthma and their funds are limited. So they stopped and gave her one of the $50 bills. And then they stopped to see Woodrow, my brother, who was in the hospital with a kidney stone. And then they came home. And the envelope had his name, M.M. White, on it. But it was full of these, it had about six $50 bills in it. And when he got home, he said to my mother, he said, I can't find that envelope. And, but it was after the tithing conversation. And he came out and gave Dad this envelope with $50 bills in it.
And that amount of money back then was...
Well, yes, and my dad was a strict... He kept track of every tomato and cucumber he sold so he could tithe it.
What can you tell us about Mama Pig?
Who?
Mama Pig, Grandma Dot's cookie jar?
Well, she taught the kids manners with the cookie jar. They learned to say, please and thank you.
Because of the pig cookie jar?
Uh-huh. She was clever. One time, she made a pot full of soup with some currants in it. Oh, wait a minute. They were pods. What would it be? Currants?
Probably.
Bertie was a cheerleader at Granite, so he had a bowl before he left early. And when we ate it, we could see little black things all over in our plates. There was a weevil in every little blob. We could hardly wait for Bertie to get home. So we could tell him about the weevil.
All right, so tell us a little bit about how you feel about alcohol.
Well, my sister... It ruined my sister's life for several years. And so I didn't like it.
Would you compare it to terrorism at all?
I called it, in my essays, I called it the liquid terrorist.
Have you submitted those essays to any major publications?
No, I haven't, but I'm pretty hard on alcohol.
Yeah.
She tried her best to get him better. And you know, later on, he became a temple worker. He repented, but she only had two children because of it.
Really? What's the title of your essays?
You know, I haven't decided. I was just going to call it a great-great-grandma's essays.
Great-great-grandma's essays.
And you know, when I talk too long, I cough.
That's okay. Do you need some water? Tell me this. How do you prefer your water?
I don't care.
Oh, you like ice water in a glass, don't you?
Yeah, right. You remember that? Well, Dad and Mother were wonderful parents.
Can you tell us a little bit about your favorite food, your favorite dessert or pie?
Well, I like lemon pie, and I like tomatoes, and I like caramels, and I hope they have chocolate up in heaven. I'm assuming I'm going to go to heaven, and I'm hoping chocolate will be
chocolate's
up there.
There. Do you think there will be football in heaven?
Well, Merritt was glad that our kids weren't big enough to play football because of the injury problem.
Tell us how you feel about football. What would you?
Well, I just quit tackling.
Quit the tackling
part? I just play touch football.
Do you think God has any concern for football?
Well, I don't think he likes the brain to be hit too hard.
Yeah.
The brain's protected with a covering, but football isn't a friend of the head, you know?
Yeah. Well, we just, I'm going to wait for this wind to calm down here real quick. Do you need any water, Grandma? We can get you a water.
I'm okay.
You're okay?
I have a cough problem. And so when I talk a lot, I cough.
Once this wind calms down, I've got a question for you. Tell me, you're talking about your cough. What does your doctor refer to your cough as?
Well, it's a form of asthma, I guess. I don't know.
But doesn't he have a specific term for it? Chronic.
I can't remember.
Chronic episodic tussis.
Oh, okay.
We just so happen to be recording this on the same day that BYU and Utah are playing their college football game against each other.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think God cares who wins that game?
Well, I'm sure that he had concern about head injuries.
Just about player safety, but not the outcome of the game?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Well, you know, they pay football players, professional football players, enough for one score as they do a professor for a whole term's work. That seems a little bit out of focus.
Yeah. So speaking of, you mentioned how you and Merritt you were lucky enough to have your kids be too small to play football. But let's talk about your family a little bit. Tell me about your kids, how many you've had.
Well, we had 11, and you know, I tell the kids it was no big deal. his colleagues didn't charge him for the delivery, and I didn't ever have any complications, any breech presentations, and I lived in the bosom of my family, and they helped me, and so it was easy. It was as easy for me to have 11 as it is for some of my kids to have one or two.
So you're not expecting your kids or grandkids to have 11 like you did?
Well, I had some special circumstances that made it easier.
All right, so I don't want to put you on the spot at all, but who's your favorite kid of your 11?
Well, I don't know. I tease. They say that my two youngest, the 10th and 11th, are both professors at the university, and I tease and say it is kind of fun to have your 10th and 11th child on faculty at the U, and I used to lead cows to water.
Is it true that,
on the farm?
Is it true that you're actually the one that got Ike his Eagle Scout?
I can't.
While he was practicing music.
I can't remember.
You can't remember. Is Kathy the smartest child, or Talmadge?
Well, Talmadge, number 10, I call him the tithing child. He's done very well in school. And Natalie, I didn't know that she was that. She's associate dean of the business school. Heavens, I could hardly keep track of my checkbook.
Well, and then your son Wynn is you know.
He travels for the general board.
Yeah, for the young for the youth, right?
They all. Kathy sends out an email, and she puts somebody's name on it each day. And because I had 11, and they all live here except one. She lives in Boise, Heather. And it's kind of interesting because the fact that I had that many, they only have to attend me two or three times a month. So one of the advantages of 11 children is that you don't have to attend grandma every day.
Right. Well, and they've just been tending you for the last two or three years, but didn't somebody else do it before then for about 5 years? Do you remember who that was?
Well, they were all very nice to me.
Can you name your 11 for me?
The oldest is Winston, Wayne, Robin, Kathy, Kathleen, Rebecca, Richard, Ike, Mike, Talmadge, Natalie. If I left anybody out, Kath, Marcia, God, I left you out.
And your Boise daughter,
Heather. She was quite beautiful.
Was she a rodeo queen?
Yeah, she was a days of 47. She was an attendant.
Do you think that had anything to do with Rod having interest in her?
I don't know. Men like beautiful girls.
What did Dr. Hall say about Heather when she was born?
He said, "You got a beautiful girl in that nursery."
So, I'm trying to think if there's anything else you want to say about your 11. I always remember the picture in your living room that says, "Behold your little ones." And it's the picture of all the baby pictures of your 11.
Well, you know, they're trying to diminish the importance of big families, but they'll never take away the joy of a posterity.
So, Merritt was very accomplished. You know, a very accomplished scholar. What did you refer to your children as?
Well, they were all pretty bright. They,
the baby pictures, you used to refer to them as something. They were your diplomas.
Oh, right.
Can yeah. you say that for me, just so it's on the mic?
Right.
What did you refer to your 11 as?
Well, I guess you could call them diplomas.
So now, talk to us a little bit about Fox News and Mitt Romney politically. Give us some of your political feedback.
Well, I think it's important that we use the scriptures more in the Bible. In Corinthians, it said, neither is the man without the woman, nor the woman without the man in the Lord. So that sort of puts the kibosh on same-sex marriage. They can just go repent.
Yeah. What do you think about China?
I feel for them. China's messed in their nest.
Say that again. They what?
Messed in their nest.
Tell us what you mean by that.
Well, they don't want them to multiply anymore.
Multiply as in the boy babies or the girl babies?
They just want to keep the boy babies, don't they?
Yeah.
That's a mistake.
About the future of all those boy babies and what the outcome of that might be?
Oh, I think the world's in trouble. I really worry about it.
There was a book you read that mentioned something about all the boy babies in China and what that would result in.
Well, they just kept they didn't want to worry about the girl babies.
And you think that'll have consequences come
sure.
like the year 2020?
Right.
What types of consequences?
Well, there won't be enough for everybody to complete their program.
Of marriage?
Mm-hmm.
And you talked about, you mentioned before a book you read that made mention of these Chinese bachelors.
Oh, yes. Natalie brought me a book. It's called What to Expect When No One is Expecting. And it is interesting because on page 99, it says that the wolf packs in Germany have gotten out of control. And they've come down from the wooded areas where the kids are. And that's a worry. And another thing on that same page, it says that they've engaged the prostitutes to help take care of the old people. Which seems strange.
Yeah.
I mean.
Didn't you read another statistic in one of those books about all of these Chinese bachelors and how they're going to be hormone laden?
Yeah, there's trouble down the road.
What does it mean if you've got a multitude of hormone laden bachelors?
Well, that is not a good equation.
It's a recipe for. I think you told me it's a recipe for either prostitution
yeah,
or homosexuality.
That's right.
Pretty disastrous.
The hope of the world is in the soul of a child.
So, on a little lighter note, less politically, well, before we transition there, tell me a little bit about Mitt Romney and President Obama while we were on the political.
Well, you know, I feel sorry for Obama because to be president of the United States is no kindergarten. Mm-hmm. And anyone who aspires to that office better get used to hard knocks, because they'll be coming. And I feel for the president because of that. I think that it's almost impossible to satisfy everybody.
Were you hopeful that Mitt Romney would have won the presidency?
Well, it would have been nice to have a Latter-day Saint as president. We may still have one.
You mentioned to me if our Heavenly Father really wanted Mitt Romney in the White House, that it wouldn't be any major task for him to...
Well, God does what he wants to do when he wants to do it. So, you know, there's a passage in the scriptures, and it says that I used to think you looked it up under hasten, but you look it up under shorten. And in this passage it says, I'll shorten the day of my coming, or there'll not be flesh on the earth. So our work's cut out for us. We live in a nuclear world, and it's troubled.
Mm-hmm.
These stakes of Zion that we have, the main mission of the Holy Writ of the Bible is to be your brother's keeper. And nothing fills that bill like ringing the world with stakes of Zion. When you go to your church each Sunday, they give you a little program and it tells who's in charge of all the things, from the Boy Scouts to the girls program to the building to the Sunday school to the Relief Society to the genealogical to temple work. We cover every single facet and make sure that everybody's cared for properly. And to ring the world with stakes of Zion, the world would not be so troublesome.
Speaking of the stakes of Zion, is it tough to find a steeple here in Utah?
A what?
A steeple, to find a chapel here in Utah, is it tough?
Oh no. If we could take a picture of all of the chapels, the world would stand in awe.
What do you think Isaiah envisioned when he spoke of a marvelous work in the world?
Well, I'm going to write a little book, and a little tiny one. I'm going to call it Thank You, Isaiah, for describing our church so nicely, because it is a marvelous work and a wonder.
Do you think he had any visions of our day?
I'm sure he did. I'm sure he did.
In Salt Lake? You told me one time how you thought when Isaiah spoke of a marvelous work and a wonder that you thought he had maybe seen, you know, Sunday morning in the...
Right. He saw us all on the way to church, Wasatch Front.
Tell me about...
Well, there's a church on every block.
So is...
In the Wasatch Front.
So, describe it in your own words. What did Isaiah say, and what do you think he saw when he was...
I just think he saw the west... I think he saw the church in Utah on Sunday morning. Everybody on their way to church.
And what did he call it?
A marvelous work and a wonder.
Okay, so on a little lighter note, tell us about some of the games you play. Don't you have a famous in the family game that you like to play?
Yeah, we played casino with rook cards, and we played old maid, and we played rook. We called it rook, and we played checkers and dominoes. And
now this casino game, is that like a game in Vegas, or tell me a little bit about it?
No, I don't know why we called it casino, but we still play it. Rick came by last Thursday and we played it. We use 10 decks of rook. Takes an hour. It takes about we play four hands, and it's really fun. I think we ought to commercialize it. It's so fun.
Who, would you consider yourself the oracle of the game?
The what?
Would you consider yourself the oracle of the game of casino?
No, we played it when I was a kid.
So who would you say is the best casino player in the family?
Well, I can, or Mike's very good, and Rick is getting better.
And Rick's showing signs of improvement.
We try to get all the red tens and all the black twos. And
so do Rick and Mike let their 91-year-old mother win at casino?
Oh no! They don't let me win.
They show no mercy.
No.
How do you feel about that?
Oh, that's okay, because I can hold my own.
You beat them on occasion?
I beat last Thursday, 23 points. That's two red tens and three blacks.
How many grandchildren do you have?
You know, I've got to count those up. I think there's about 100.
Yeah.
I've got one great-grandchild that just finished his mission in Ecuador. And when he gets married and has children, I'll be a great-great. And one of the most wonderful things that has happened is that one of our grandchildren is a physician. And he was asked to go down and help Haiti after the earthquake. And he
Hold
brought
on a second. This window is gonna blow your, we won't hear you very well.
He brought home two little patients, adopted them. And then he went back to help some more and brought home three more. Two teenage girls whom he's already baptized, and another little boy. So I have five Haitians in my family tree.
Wow. So if you had to estimate between your 11, your grands, and your great grands, how large is your posterity?
Well, there's about 250 of us.
That's remarkable.
Yeah, it is. But you know, they help each other.
If you were to deliver a message to your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren, what would you want them to know? What would you tell them?
Well, I would tell them to take very seriously the mandate of being your brother's keeper, which is reiterated in the Bible. And I would tell them to be strict attendees to their neighborhood wards and help with the cause. And because if anything's gonna save the world, it's these stakes of Zion. The nuclear aspect is very challenging, and so we've got our work cut out for us. The missionary effort is so wonderful. Ike, your father, has had eight boys and they've all gone. That's quite an accomplishment.
Do you recall where your boys served?
Two went to Germany, one went to Canada, two went to England, one went to Venezuela, one went to Japan.
Was the Venezuela Argentina with Mike?
Yeah. He learned Spanish. Mm-hmm. They say that every fourth child born will be Spanish.
Wow.
In fact, tell your friends to look it up under, and I've told you this in the interview, don't look up the word hasten. Look up the word shorten, and the Doctrine and Covenant says that he will shorten the day of his coming, or there will not be flesh on the earth. So that sounds a bit nuclear. Our work's cut out for us.
You know your scriptures quite well. You're quite the little missionary.
I would love to go out
What did Merritt call you? Think in light of your missionary.
Oh, he thought I was pretty forthright. Whenever we'd go on trips, I didn't have to know somebody very long before they got the lessons.
did he call you his little...
What was it, Marcia?
Little Bible girl?
Oh, Bible girl. Well, we've got a treasure in our midst, and we must
share it,
support it.
Yeah. So, in light of your strong testimony of missionary work, tell us a little bit about the restoration and how you feel about Joseph Smith.
Well, you know, Joseph Smith, there was a revival going on, and his sister had already joined a church. His mother was entertaining the possibility, and so there was a lot of conversation, and he ran across the passage, "If any of ye lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not." And he couldn't get that out of his mind. It kept reoccurring. And so he had picked out the place where he was going to pray. It was in a grove, and he decided where he was going to go by some logs. And on the way there, he was accosted. There was somebody who didn't want that to happen. The powers of evil or satanic influence tried to talk him out of it. He felt the influence to skip it. Don't do it. But he didn't pay any attention. He decided he was going to do it anyway. And that, I think that's comforting, because we know even though Satan has great powers, he's not chairman of the board. He's, when Joseph Smith felt the evil influence, he prayed about it and it left him. And so as a result, he talked with God. And you know, he saw his brother Hiram take a bullet in his cheek at the Carthage jail, and his own personal safety, because he was in the next room, would have said, "You better clear out of here, forget this restoration." But he didn't. He had seen God and had talked to him and Christ, and he wasn't going to. So he got shot too, you know. Both he and his brother were killed. And I hope that we remember that, what they did for the gospel's sake.
You used to always remind me that Joseph Smith wrote that the ends of the earth would
inquire after his name.
You find that remarkable?
Yeah, it's going to happen. It's happening every day. We're even sending out 18-year-old girls. So there's a time element involved to send out young girls like that. We've got our work cut out for us.
No doubt.
And it's a privilege to represent God in the mission field. I was pleased that our kids all went. We always have a prayer when they leave.
When your kids leave?
They take hold of my hand, and we have a prayer before they leave. And it's quite wonderful to hear your children pray in your kitchen while you're holding their hand. You know, there's a saying, "Know this, that every soul is free to choose his life and what he'll be. For this eternal truth is given, that God will force no man to heaven. Freedom and reason make us men. Take that away, what are we then? Animals." So we can be glad for the missionary system that brought our ancestors into the fold. We can be glad that we have a chance to carry that on by sending out our own boys. We can be a chance, even after we die, in the spirit world, to still do some proselyting. I thought it was quite interesting that this man that thought up this little iPod thing, that he died of cancer, and I think it was cancer. Anyway, it was so interesting because just before he died, his name was
Steve Jobs.
He said, wow, 3 times. Wow, wow, wow. So whoever admitted him into the spirit realm prompted that kind of a expression. Wow, wow, wow.
He had another, along with his iPod, he invented the iPhone, right?
Yeah.
What are your thoughts about this little gadget?
Well, when he died, he said, wow, 3 times. So I think whoever admitted Jobs into the spirit world gave him a kind of a special how-to-do.
a very special welcome.
Well, he wanted him to know that they were glad that he was smart enough to bring the scriptures in the palm of your hand, but he definitely found out, apparently, who's in charge.
What do you refer to the iPhone as? Scripturally speaking, there's a little, in the scriptures it speaks of a stone.
Yeah, well, I think it's important because our time we don't have a long time to preach the gospel. The nuclear thing has changed that.
Huh?
There's another scripture that I think's very important. It says that not just those that say, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom, but he that doeth the will. So you got to do more than just talk. You got to act to make the world better. And we're going to win the battle, but it's our work's cut out for us. Just pick up the newspaper each day and you can see that. You can see why they're ever increasing the missionary effort.
A second ago we were talking about Steve Jobs and Apple. What does the iPhone remind you of?
Urim and Thummim.
The what?
Urim and Thummim.
Tell me a little bit about it.
Well, it's full of truth.
It's a source of all things present, past, and
to come.
And things to come.
Well, I just love the missionary work.
Didn't you write a little book about it?
I wrote a little book about it. It's called Dear Gabriel, about two girls that love the church. We've got our work cut out for us because the adversary is pretty potent.
What other book did you write?
Well, I did that White Acres, you know, that red book.
Tell me what's that all about.
It just tells about my ancestors coming over to America.
Are we on the White Acres?
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember what the White Acres was purchased for?
Well, they got a Lincoln land grant. It's a mile. I just know that it's a mile south of Highland High, and it was, my dad just thought it was so choice. We call it White, that's why I called my book White Acres.
White Acres. I remember in your book it mentions the $70 land grant, and there was one other part of the purchase. Do you remember what it was?
No.
A half a barrel of molasses.
Oh, yeah. Well, it was nice to grow up in a household of faith.
So remind me again, how far back was it? Your dad's dad Tell me who bought the White Acres.
My dad's dad. His name was...
Edward?
Edward.
And he bought the White Acres for how much?
Well, I don't know. They had Lincoln land grants, and they got it at a discount, but I don't know the exact price.
You don't recall?
I just know that Kenwood Ward was built on Uncle Henry's property, and Grandview Ward was built on Uncle Matthew's property.
But you still live on the White Acres.
Yeah.
Do you know...
We're still here.
What would your guess be? You know, your grandpa bought the White Acres for a $70 land grant and a half a barrel of molasses. What would you say a property is going for here?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. I just know that we got to name the streets. We've got a White Avenue and a LaRue Lane and a Mary Dot Way and Ida Circle and... So we've been here a long time.
All right, so let's talk a little bit about, you told me one time if you were to go to heaven tomorrow, you'd have three questions for God. Do you remember what you'd want to ask him about?
Well, I would wonder how long it'll be before, you know, righteousness triumphs. Mm-hmm.
You were going to ask him something about gravity.
Oh, yeah. That's always been a puzzle, gravity. That's pretty complicated.
Just the concept of weight?
Yeah. And, you know, I've grown up with someone said that the temple would stand when those mountains fell. I don't know who said that. That's pretty brave. That's pretty assertive.
The other thing that surprises you or that you find remarkable about gravity is all the buildings in New York City, don't you?
Yeah.
Tell me about that.
Well, you just wonder how it's all gonna... That passage where it says, I'll shorten the day of my coming or there'll not be flesh on the earth. You can see how that can happen.
Yeah. The other thing you mentioned about wanting to ask God about is numbers.
Yeah, that's right.
Explain that a little bit.
Well, the worth of a human being is pretty important. Worlds without number hath he created. So
he compares them to something.
You kind of...
What does the Lord compare? These worlds have I created. They numbered as the... Sands of the
seashore, yeah.
So why are you so intrigued by numbers? What do you want to know about numbers?
Well, you wonder why, how is he going to tend us all, you know?
We seem so numerous.
Yeah.
How does he keep track of us all?
Right. That's why he has stakes of Zion, so that they're intendable units, you know.
I've got a couple other questions here for you. And maybe while I'm getting to those, actually, let's do this real quick. So I asked you what you would say to your grandchildren and great-grandchildren. But let's be more specific than that. What would you say to one of your grandchildren who's recently married?
Well, pay attention to what you promised at the altars in the temple. And know this, that every soul is free to choose his life and what he'll be. And so we get our agencies there. We just ought to be clever enough and insightful enough to choose the right.
And then let's fast forward that married couple of a year or two down the road and they just had a newborn baby. What would your advice be to them now?
Just tell them that the hope of the world is in the soul of a child. I'm glad that Joseph Smith's mother, dad had Joseph Smith.
And then you've got a lot of great-grandchildren. One, your eldest great-grandson that just returned from his mission. You had other greats that were about to leave on a mission?
Well, I don't know.
What would you say to them, the ones that are about to leave?
Just rejoice in the fact that you're sharing the marvelous work and a wonder. And you're bringing people into the fold, and you're helping them find happiness.
I kind of sent out a little text message to some of our family members about what they would want us to ask you. One of their responses was, ask Grandma about love. What she thinks love is.
Well, it makes the world go round. Love's pretty important. God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life.
So, speaking of God's Son, Christ, can you bear us your testimony of Christ?
Right.
Can you share it with us? Share
you
it
bet.
If you were to speak of your testimony.
I just believe it with all my heart and soul, and I hope that the children don't get too caught up in materialism, that they'll remember the concept of the gospel and how wonderful it is, and that's the only true way to happiness.
Have you, this is on a much lighter note, your front yard has a tennis court, right? Did you play tennis in your youth?
Oh yeah, I've got some tennis trophies. Mike and I won the mother-son championship while his wife was in the hospital having a baby. She actually had the baby while we were still on the court.
Did you have any nicknames out on the tennis court?
Well, I do tell the kids when they come to play, I say, always take a step. Don't get too close to the ball. If you take a step before you hit it, then you get a better swing, and you're apt to hit it in the middle of the racket. And if you hit it in the middle of the racket, it'll go where you want it to go. So that's the best advice I can give a tennis player. Don't get too close to the ball. Get a good...
Did you usually hit a pretty straight, solid shot, or would you hit it up?
Oh, I was called the lob queen.
There you go. That's what I'm looking for. They'd call you what again?
The lob queen. Yeah,
that's
fun.
Oh, that's awesome. I'm trying to think. You guys, can you think of anything else? Oh yeah, tell me a little bit about your cane.
My what?
Your cane. Your walking.
Oh, this cane. They had a tornado in Salt Lake, and it was heading up toward the temple. And when it got by the temple, it turned east and went up to the Capitol instead. And the debris from the tornado, they made a desk. Natalie's husband is a craftsman, and he made the desk. And he made me this cane out of the leftovers. So this was actually made from the tornado that was heading toward the temple, and then it moved and went up to the Capitol.
Does that cane double as a weapon?
No, he just made it and gave it to me.
Yes.
It's kind of fun to have a cane that was made from a tornado.
Yeah. It's got some history. It's been through a storm or two. A lot of the political news right now is centered around guns. Do you have any thoughts on that topic?
Well, my dad went deer hunting once a year, and we had a gun in the house, but I think that I'm glad that my kids don't hunt much.
Like Ike?
Does he hunt? Well, somebody in your family hunts, because the boy that lives in my basement goes hunting.
Yeah, that's Ike's family. They love hunting. Tell me your fondest memory of Merritt.
Well, he was so wonderful and sweet. He believed in putting important things top priority, and he loved his parents, and he loved his brothers and sisters.
If you wanted Merritt to wear a matching outfit with you, was he okay with that?
Yeah, he put up with some of my frivolity.
So if you were wearing red, would he be wearing red?
Oh, well, he'd wear a red tie, maybe, but...
Like right now with your navy outfit? Because I always remember at the Egan family Christmas parties, the two of you would be matching.
Yeah, we would get shirts that matched. You like him to know who he belongs to. Uh-huh. And who you belong to.
And did he have was there anything unique about his departure from this world?
Well,
like when it happened?
He died on my birthday, and the boys gave him a bath after he died, and they didn't put shoes on him, but they tied up his chin and put a sweater on him, and the kids gave him hugs, and we had our supper. And when they came for Merritt's body, they said, "Is there a dead person here?" Because we were having a party. But it was my birthday, and that's what he would have wanted. So
you didn't mind him leaving on your birthday?
No. And you know, I have a little white scarf in this picture in my kitchen, and I've told your brother, who lives downstairs, if you catch me with my mouth awry, don't forget to tie up my chin. Because you look better after you die if your chin's tied up. And I don't think he would like the thoughts of that too much, but.
Do you still anticipate Grandpa Merritt paying you a visit?
Well, I'm hoping that he'll be on the welcoming committee.
But I mean, here, haven't you mentioned to me before about you're hoping that he'd maybe come to you in a dream or?
Well, you know, I saw the room spinning the other night, and I thought, "Ooh, is this the end?" But it stopped spinning, and it wasn't the end.
And Merritt didn't show up. Speaking of that welcoming committee, who would you like to be the one to greet you on the other side?
Well, I would like Merritt to come and...
Anybody else you'd put on that committee?
No, that's enough. Maybe he's found my sister, and maybe he's got a polygamous wife already. Merritt's married LaRue.
They're not given in marriage.
They aren't?
I don't think so.
Well.
So your daughter, Dot, has her grandma Polka Dot, you know, videos and children's stories and puppet shows. How do you feel about all that?
It's okay. She's clever. She knows how to deal with the young minds, and if it teaches them to walk in the paths of righteous endeavor, more power to her.
She calls herself Grandma Polka Dot. What would you call yourself?
Well, all I know is that if Wynn's boy, grandson, gets married and has children and makes me a great grandma, that'll be pretty fun.
So you'd call yourself
to have
great,
that
great?
In your obituary. You don't see great great very often.
So you'll you'll let Grandma Polka Dot be referred to as Grandma Polka Dot as long as we can refer to you as Great Great.
Right. Great Greats, you have to be well in your 90s.
Yeah. I think that might be all that I have, Grandma.
Well, it's certainly nice of you to interview me, and so I could, I would have done a better job 2 or 3 years ago, I think.
Oh, you've done fantastic. Tell me a little bit about your scarf, or your scarves. You're quite the collector.
Oh, well, you know, they say if you want to look younger, cover up your neck.
And you like to keep up appearances?
Well, I guess that's part of being a woman.
Are you, there's a rumor going around in the family that you're handing out your jewelry.
Oh, I've told the kids if they see something they like, help themselves. Wayne wants my piano. And what do you want, Marcia Dopp?
What's your favorite material possession of all time?
Well, Merrick got me this diamond at Tel Aviv, at the Holy Land, and that goes to Natalie.
In where? Tel Aviv? Tell me where that is. Tell me where that is. Where is that in the world?
It's Bethlehem, or it's Jerusalem.
There we go. That's what I was looking for.
And we kept the bus waiting while they sized it. When they saw what he had got me, they thought that was pretty neat.
Do you guys have any other ideas? Do you have any other stories or things you want to, any poems? There's a poem.
Oh, yeah, Poppy Fields.
Tell us your Poppy Fields poem.
The what?
Poppy Fields? Poppy Fields. How does it start?
Row on row on poppy fields.
Row on row on poppy fields. Remember that poem?
No. My mother was a great one for poems.
Hey, didn't you have a dog growing up?
Pedro.
Tell me about him.
He was a Mexican Chihuahua. He's a cute little dog.
What was his name?
Pedro.
Did he have to cross the border?
No, my dad was a mail carrier, and one of the people on his route gave the dog to him.
It's like, here we lie, the poppies row by row.
I can't hear you.
The poppies row by row, here we lie beneath the poppies row by row. Flounders Field.
In Flanders Fields, the poppies grow. Between the crosses, row on row, which mark our place, and in the sky the larks still bravely singing fly, scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago, we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, but now we lie in Flanders Field. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you, with failing hands, we throw the torch, be yours to hold it high. If ye lose faith in us who die, we shall not sleep though poppies grow in Flanders Field.
So, one of your boys went to Vietnam, right? Who went to Vietnam?
Wayne.
And you had a little prayer for him one time, didn't you? Can you tell me about that?
Well, it's a new experience to have a boy in combat.
You were going up the stairs one time and you had a little prayer on his behalf.
Yeah.
Can you tell me about it?
I can't remember the incident.
Right in the middle of the stairs.
You
didn't make it all the way up.
I don't know why. I was on my way upstairs and why I knelt down on one special step. I guess he was in some kind of trouble. We never did equate it too accurately, but...
But he made it back safe.
Yeah.
That prayer was in this home right here.
Uh-huh.
Tell me about your house. How many bathrooms do you have?
Well, my grandmother, when she took a bath, they brought in water from the irrigation ditch and they poured it in a galvanized tub in front of a coal stove. And I've got four bathrooms in that house. Doesn't seem fair, does it?
So what do you, there are three things that you think everybody should learn. Do you remember what those are?
Well, they must learn where they came from, why they're here, and where they're going.
Plan of salvation. Mm-hmm. And then just in life, though, you recommended that they learn a language.
Yeah, it's nice to not forget anybody.
Well, but what language would you suggest? Like, for instance, I only speak English. So would you suggest that I learn a second language?
Well, they say that every fourth child born will be Spanish. So if you want to do a lot of missionary work, learn Spanish.
Is that a lake in your backyard, or what do you have in your backyard? There's a big body of water in your backyard.
Oh,
what is that?
Well, that's kind of a... I have to apologize for that, really. But it's a place of camaraderie, and they have had a lot of fun there.
It's a little swimming pool?
Mm-hmm. My dad would have thought that was an extravagance.
Who put it in?
Merritt did?
Mm-hmm.
And
must
we've
have been
had
quite the thing back in the day to have a swimming pool in your backyard.
Yeah.
And a tennis court in your front yard, for that matter.
Well, we used to live in this house.
Uh-huh.
The tennis court was in our backyard. And don't get too close to the ball. Color?
What's your favorite color?
I like white.
And, what was your favorite age to be?
Well, you do get so you kind of hurt on your little ischial tuberosity, tailbone. And it's getting so if I can't bring things to my memory as readily. And you get, I'm trying to remember everybody's wife's name and husband's name, and I have a little niece that helps me a lot.
Grandma, tell me again about the marvelous work and a wonder. Talk about what Isaiah saw.
Well, he saw the church in our day. And
what did he say? What was the quote from the scripture? Quote the scripture for me and then tell me about it.
He said, I think he saw the stakes of Zion circling the earth.
And what was the phrase he used to describe it?
A marvelous work and a wonder.
You think that's taking place?
Yep.
Since Merritt's passing, you've had some high priests in the ward kind of giving you the eye, haven't you?
Oh, no. I don't think so.
Oh, yeah. There's another scripture that you always refer to about the things that God has prepared for us in heaven. Eye hath not seen.
See, nor ear heard, neither hath it entered into the heart of man what I have in store for those who love me and keep my commandments.
So say it one more time from the start.
Eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither hath it entered into the heart of man what I have in store for those who love me and keep my commandments. So, their rewards.
What's your lipstick color of choice? What color of lipstick do you prefer?
I don't know.
You always had a particular color of lipstick in your bag.
I can't remember, Peggy.
Salmon.
Or Mary? Or
salmon.
Marcia?
Salmon.
Salmon? I want you to buy the film.
Buy the film? I can't take your $20.
I want yours. It'll just sit there. I can afford it more than right now.
Love you, Grandma.
Yeah, thank you. It was nice. Your dad's coming to get me at 7.
Oh, are you still recording him?
Who is your favorite child? Your namesake? Is it your namesake?
I spelled your name different.
But aren't I your favorite? Just say it once. Just say it for posterity. Who's your favorite?
Well, I like them all the same.
I know, but it's really Ike, right?
Ike?
Uh-huh. How about Wynn?
Well, Ike.
In the text messages that I got, I was told to ask who your favorite was after Wynn and Kathy.
No, who's your favorite after Wynn and Ike?
Ike is, could have been world famous.
Well, he was with the Osmonds, but just say it once.
Oh, they, you know, when we heard that, when we heard the Osmonds were going to be at Vegas, we decided to go so we could hear him. We could hear Ike, but we never saw him.
Grandma, I want you to tell
me. He was well hidden.
Do you believe in the power of the resurrection? Tell me about it.
Well, we know that not a hair on the head shall be lost.
You're pretty certain of that?
Yeah, I hope so. I kind of hope they have chocolate up there.
You really enjoy chocolate, don't you?
I like chocolate.
Any other things that you particularly enjoy?
Well, I like to see the kids. When I pass through the veil, and there are a lot of trinkets, there's a lot of stuff in my house, and I hope they can deal with it cordially. You know, I have a book, and the name of the book is Stuff. And I hope that they are, you know, generous and sweet with each other.
What's the book Stuff about?
I don't know.
Stuff?
It's just called Stuff. Standing position.
You've always been one for the stage, haven't you?
Well, I could step close rock.
That was, I'm just, Deb, and you know what's funny is you thought the same things were funny I did. That was also funny.
What?
You just, he thought Grandma, the same things were funny that I thought were funny.
Grandma, didn't you, wasn't there a time where in church or at a ward function, somebody made the mistake of giving you the mic?
Well, that was a mistake.
You kind of stole the show.
She's a tap dancer. She clicks up her heels.
You've taught all your grandkids step close rock. I've used that on Emily a couple times.
Oh yeah, you can pick up the beat. You can do it to "We Thank Thee, O God, for a Prophet." I love you with all my heart. Remember to live the gospel and know the joy of the temple, and know that when I leave, I'll think of you and pray for you. And I'll tell Merritt that you're all doing a good job.